yet the issues of acts of worship. Once you define the acts of worship and fix them, everything else in the Sharia should be subject to the ethical dimension of them and the ethical purpose of them. And therefore, this gives flexibility to achieve and realize the ethical dimension of Islam in various circumstances and across different cultures and across different times. And that is how you can bridge the gap between virtue ethics and applied ethics. When you consider at-ta'abbud, when you consider pure worship as a virtue, and you say that everything is subject to virtues, including the virtue of pure worship, and you define in Islam, of course, in a scholarly way, which therefore you'll have some differences, and you'll have things that are definitely pure acts of worship, and things that people will differ over, and so forth. But then you define the pure acts of worship, and you say that the virtue in that is pure worship, pure obedience, as Shatibi put it, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the rest would be subject to virtues. And therefore, you have a new science of applied ethics, which we used to call fiqh, but now we look at fiqh in terms of ethics. Now we can merge fiqh and ethics in the applied ethics. Applied ethics would be fiqh of today, in which you think about matters based on how much ethics they hold, the acts, the do's and the don'ts in the Islamic law will actually be based on the ethical content. Where are the scripts here? Well, the scripts are the source of the virtues. The scripts are the source of the default ruling. The letter of the script is the source of the default ruling. But the default ruling could change if the change of circumstances and place and time would dictate a change of these rulings based on the ethical purpose of the ruling. So that we go back to Ibn al-Qayyim's asl that he put, but he did not activate, which is anything that takes Sharia from justice to injustice, from wisdom to the lack thereof, from good to mischief, then it's not Sharia, even if people claim it to be so according to some interpretation. So that's just the idea that I thought I should propose today, to bridge the gap between theoretical ethics and applied ethics. I summarized some of the topics in the wordings. I assumed a level of background in some issues. So if there is anything that needs to be clarified or discussed, please let me know. And thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Jasser, for this lecture, which is at the same time the introduction of a series of lectures that we will have here around this topic, which, as you know, it's Islamic ethics, classical and contemporary perspective. It's a very good and quite deep introduction to the topic, and we want to have this discussion, as you were saying, between the Oxford Center for Islamic Studies, the Middle East Center, and the Center for Islamic Legislation and Ethics. Dr. Jasser is the deputy director, and this is exactly what the center is trying to do. It's just how do we connect, you know, fiqh and Islamic legislation with the ethical perspective, in the way he was trying to translate what should fiqh be today. But before coming to implementing, I think that he started with a kind of outlines and framework through which we can look at these questions, and it might be interesting to start our discussion with this and then to go towards something which may be more practical for today. But this is the theoretical introduction to it. So the floor is yours. I think that we can just start with question and respond to. So, Dr. Heba, we start with you.
First of all, thank you very much. My name is Eva Edward, I'm a fellow at the center, and I come from Canada. I just thought, while you were talking, I kept thinking and reflecting about the cosmological dimension of Sharia. You know, so I wanted very much to suggest to you, if you are working on the topic, that you are, that you link that as well with the redefinition of law when we compare it to Sharia. I think that in Islam, we do not see Sharia as law as in the modern state. Its aim is actually not only justice, so we're not talking about justice systems in the applied sense, but we're talking about harmony. We're talking about achieving peace and happiness. And we're talking about the relation between the individual and others, his human nature and sunnah, and the laws of God in nature, not in the legal sense, but in the sort of the systematic sense that you are expert in. So I think that if we put this back through these different notions, they might clarify what is meant by the wisdom of God in Sharia that is very much linked, not only in the legal dimension, so you have been trying to sort of embed the legal and the moral, but also see the moral in everything, see the notions of justice spread in the universe in everything. And so if you touch upon that, that might take you not only to the maqasid and to the fiqh, but it might take you also to Sufism and philosophy. And here comes the dimension that I think should be added to the discussion.
Thank you so much. Thank you for the correction that I should have mentioned that between brackets when I talk about Islamic law. I don't mean law in the Qanun sense, in the canon law, or I wasn't talking about the state, I'm talking about ethics, really. Like law as a Sharia, Shara'a yashru'u, the word means a way of life, really. Sharia is translated as a way of life, as Dr. Tariq translated in his books, and I actually referred to that when I translated the word Sharia. So it is often thought of as a law, whether in the Qanun sense, in the legal system kind of sense, but that has nothing to do with the original Sharia. In fact, the law in the legal system kind of sense is a kind of, let's say, I don't know, post-colonial thing in the Islamic part of the world. It is not, it was in the courts, of course, before, but Qanun, the constitution and so on, and that's new. That is not Sharia originally. But thank you so much, and especially your reference to Sunan or the universal laws. They are very much connected.
I would also introduce the notion of how you relate the law as between human beings, with the level of relation between human beings and individuals and society, etc., and the wider sort of laws of God in the universe.
Yeah, sure. Thank you so much. And as well, referring to Sufism, actually, that is part of the Islamic ethics. It's not part of virtue ethics proper in the Western sense of the word, because one of the virtues in Islam is a ta'abud, this act of worship, pure worship. That pure worship is a Sufi notion. It is not an Aristotelian notion, when you think about the virtues. So that is something that, yes, has to be added to the picture. Thank you.
If I may, yeah. Because you seem to be agreeing here, and that's okay, but can I ask a simple question?
Sure.
What are the practical implications of what you are saying?
I think it's
both of you, because it's okay. I can understand the cosmological dimension. What does it mean, practically speaking?
I think the meaning of the dimension of practicality is something that keeps unfolding within the process of Ijtihad. So I can't give you a definition, but it's rather how the
No, I'm not asking about practical answers, but in the way we are going to deal with the text, in the way we are going to deal with ethics, what does it mean? What does it mean that to think more about harmony?
Mind is something like interdisciplinarity, for example, that you try to relate the social with the natural and see the relevance, because it's all the creation of God. So this is one of the things that might open up in this domain to relate the specific to the universal. So because of what I just mentioned, we relate to other shara'ah, we relate to other ways of life and books of life when they come from the same origin of revelation in prophethood and in revelation in other religions. So there must be something in between, some link, because even if the laws of God in different religions change, we did not change, God did not change, and the universe did not change. So here there must be something minimal, universal, and you're trying to see that as well. So it might open up different topics to explore.
Well, the pure worship doesn't have to have a practical side. I mean, it is a feeling. It is an experience, and the experience then manifests in practical ways, in different ways. I mean, people could have this worship experience.
What if a faqih is telling you, "You are losing me in the cosmos"?
You are losing
me in the cosmos. How am I going to deal with law and rules if it's all about the cosmos?
Yeah, but why is the faqih the center of that cosmos? I mean, it doesn't have to be. I mean, because the Islamic law is a rule of life. Yes, it regulates people and resolve the conflicts, etc. But that's not the whole story. That's a very small part of the story. In fact, the bigger part of the story is the personal experience of it, which is the acts of worship. When I practice worship, it improves my quality of life, regardless of the law in the legal sense.
Thank you very much. I found it very revealing. I wonder, does the principle of the Hanafi, specifically istihsan, and the Maliki principle, the Masliha, does both these principles don't have any relationship with the ethical aspect of the Sharia?
Mm-hmm.
Then another question is that when the Shafi'i was formulating his Maqasid principle, and in practice he did not apply this principle to his fatawa, so what was the purpose behind this intellectual exercise?
Thank you. Istihsan, I think, is It implies an ethical reconsideration of the qiyas, but it is solving a problem that does not have to exist to start with. You see, Abu Hanifa applied the istihsan in a stukbih al qiyas, you know, when the analogy becomes ugly. But why do you have to do analogy to start with? You see, like, why do you have to do analogy in the Greek way? Like with the illah and mundabita and all of that. So if you give up the indibat of al-ilm, the exactness of the rationale, for the best of my translation. So if you give up that exactness of the rationale and the indibat al-ilm to adam indibat al-hikmah, and then you don't have to do istihsan, because you base the rule on the hikmah. Given that you keep the acts of worship intact, then you are safe from the dissolving of the sharia that the scholars had concerns about. You see what I mean? So I think istihsan and maslaha were steps in the right direction, but they tried to solve a problem that didn't have to exist to start with. Why do we say Quran and Sunnah and ijma' and qiyas and then maslaha? But the Quran is the maslaha. Like, the Quran is saying do maslaha. So why do we say we look into the Quran? If we don't find, then we take the maslaha. Well, how come I don't find maslaha in the Quran? Just because the expression was general, then it is not specified in the Quran. So if the Quran is talking about justice and something has a justice element of it, I apply the justice element, and that is the Quran. I don't have to say that I didn't find anything in the Quran just because the Quran did not say, "All who believe, if you would like to transplant an arm, then do that." The Quran doesn't have to say that. Then I apply justice or whatever to the transplantation issue, for example, that is in hand, and I say that this is in the Quran, and it's not maslaha. So, regarding Shatibi was an usul. So, you know how the usulis do. They do usul and philosophy for their career, as you know. But then to apply it, that's a different story, because if he applies that, this means that as a judge, he will have different judgments. And that was not politically acceptable. There is a difference between Shatibi al-Usuli and Shatibi al-Faqih, I think for political reasons. The same difference between Ibn Rushd al-Usuli and Ibn Rushd al-Faqih. That's very different. Because had Ibn Rushd applied all this philosophy to his fiqh, he would have a very different fiqh. And that, as a judge, might not be acceptable. He was a Maliki judge. He had to go Maliki when it comes to fiqh. That's my understanding of it.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you very much for this enlightening talk. I have a few comments and one question. You mentioned justice and wisdom. These are very subjective terms. And even when you're saying ethics, I don't know what you mean from fiqh perspective. Do you mean akhlaq or whatever? And when it comes to practicalities, it will pose their own problems because justice, according to you, would be very different and according to me, would be entirely different.
Mm-hmm.
And secondly, one question that fiqh has survived up till now for hundreds of years. Why now we are thinking that we need to just differentiate? Yes, scholars have been thinking about it. So there were some reasons because of change of time and space requires change of rules, which strict application of principles of faith to adopt. But why we are thinking about adopting the solution you're providing now?
Well, thank you so much. I guess your first question. The key word in it is subjective. If you don't look at things in terms of either subjective or objective, then you can solve the problem. Because I mean, I don't know. I come from a philosophical background where I don't believe in dichotomies. So the issue of subjective itself. Like for the maqasid or for the hikmah or for justice to be subjective, I would say that everything is collectively subjective rather than objective versus subjective. So if you look at something that is collectively subjective, but everybody believes that it is the demand of justice to allow this or not to allow that, then perhaps has something to do with ijma', if you would like a classical way of looking at it. So if there is an overwhelming ijma' about the injustice of something, then it becomes haram. I understand that injustice is subjective in your school of looking at subjective versus objective. But what is objective anyway? What the scholars said about objective is that the language is objective. So, you know, al-amru yaqtadi al-wujub, order means obligation. They thought that this is objective. I don't think it's objective. I think it's still subjective. Because al-amru yaqtadi al-wujub, ma lam yasrifu wasa'if, order implies obligation unless there is a doubt. And there is always a doubt in orders. Because there is always a way of interpreting an order, except for like very basic things in Islam. But there is always a way of interpreting an order to mean a different maslaha. So I have a problem with the subjective objective. And based on me having a problem with the subjective objective classification, I wouldn't have a problem with the maqasid and the masalih and justice and so forth. Regarding of why now do you think this way? No, we've been thinking this way all along. Fiqh was always renewed. But now, what we call ethics, brings to mind, what we call ethics is actually fiqh, but it brings to mind the applications. When we say applied ethics, and in the center that I'm honored to work with my brother Dr. Tariq in, we have a number of areas of applied ethics that we would like to bring ethics to. So for example, ethics of the environment, ethics in politics, ethics in psychology, education, gender studies, environment. So when I talk about ethics of the environment, this is fiqh, this is not new. But today's language, we call it ethics of the environment. And perhaps just giving it a different name would allow us to do the tajdeed without somebody telling me that, well, no, you are saying that something is haram, but it's not in the fiqh. And I don't want you to get into the haram halal area. I want you to talk about ethics in terms of being nice, not in terms of a religious obligation. Yet, we have religious obligations towards the environment. We have religious obligation towards politics, for that matter, and so on. So, yes. Oh, sorry. Excuse me.
Okay, go ahead, Dea.
With respect to Sharia law, that's speaking as a complete outsider. But one of the problems with Sharia law, as pointed out by Dr. Hadi Fahmy yesterday, was that it regards Muslims and non-Muslims as different. That is, there isn't equality in law as regards Muslims and non-Muslims, men and women. And this seems to me a very fundamental problem.
Inequality in terms of what?
Well, inequality in the way one is assessed in any legal verdict. If a Muslim is not going to be regarded in the same light as a non-Muslim, the woman is a testimony is only regarded as half the weight of a man. That makes a considerable difference.
Well, these are two different issues. I think the issue of Muslim versus non-Muslim. The Islamic law, let's say in the legal sense, has room for what's called parallel laws. And I know this is a major sin in Western law or whatever, but the Islamic law believes in partial parallel laws, and especially in the family law. It believes that Muslims should have their own family law and non-Muslims should have their own family law. But in terms of anything else that is public, the Islamic law is equal for everybody. That's my understanding of the Islamic law. I understand that some people have different opinions, but I think they are incorrect. In terms of men and women, that's a different question because men and women have different rules based on roles, and I know that roles as well is sin as a word, but let me say that that appears, for example, in some of the custody laws in the Islamic law, because the mother is closer to the children who are younger, and that is why that is the ethics behind it, that's the purpose behind it, that she would have an upper hand on the custody versus the father. In terms of the witnesses, no, the opinion I take is that there is only one witness. When the Quran mentioned two witnesses, it mentions one witness, as most of the Mufassirin said, the people who interpreted the Quran, there is only one witness and the other one is reminding her. And that's if the society has this as a norm or something. I mean, not everything that is in the Quran is not subject to history or culture, and the equality of men and women, as my brother was saying, is also a subjective thing that is subject to circumstances, historical circumstances. So if you ask me my opinion today, no, I believe today that men and women have equal witnessing capacities. From the Islamic law, that's there is nothing to make the woman's legal capacity less than the man in the Islamic law. It happened in history, and many things happened in history, and they were justified too. And many things happen today, and they might be justified in terms of the difference between justice and equality. If you want to equate everybody, it's not justice. I don't know if I'm making sense.
Try to summarize what we heard yesterday, because he was referring to the understanding of Sharia by the Salafi people, and in their understanding of Sharia, it's quite clear, it's not just, there is no equality, we need two women for a man, so it means that what you are saying is another understanding of Sharia, or are they wrong? Or is there something that we have to integrate within Sharia, which is coming from outside?
I believe they are wrong, but I could be wrong, as the great imams have said. And they believe that I am wrong, but they could be wrong. So I think they are wrong. But, I mean, these are different ways of understanding things. This is nothing definite in Islam. The legal capacity of women. In fact, to also add maybe a little bit, all areas in the Islamic law that have to do with women issues and so on have like require major revisions. This is one of the areas. I wrote in some of the articles that there are two areas that require revision in the Islamic law, like basically the area of Islam and politics and the area of Islam and women. And we have problems historically from that. But I don't believe in that women's legal capacity, to use a legal term, is less than men's. No, why? What in the Islamic law is saying that? The verse, well, the verse is talking about a specific society, and that is not... And I'm not historicizing the Quran either, as well, between brackets. It's not about that, but it's just about, you know, not everything... When the Quran talks about horses and arrows, we're not supposed to be, you know, riding horses and using arrows, really. There are things that are means to an end, and there are things that are ends in themselves.
It's okay. Yes.
Yeah, thank you very much. Actually, some scholars say the meaning of Islamic law is different right now for modern Muslims. Because for Muslims in the past, in addition to halal and haram, legal and illegal, there were other customs, such as, for example, makruh and mustahab. But they say right now the Muslims, especially the nation state, they see the Islamic law as like modern law, and they just care if it's legal or illegal. So they lost these values in modern times. So what do you think about this comment?
I think it's very true. I think speaking in terms of the legal system, like emphasizing too much the legal system in the Islamic, especially the debate now in the Middle East, the post-revolution debate in Tunis or Egypt or other countries in Yemen, people are talking about bringing Islam back to the law. And I think that is not the solution for the development of the Islamic cause in these countries. The development of the Islamic cause should be through the development of the Islamic society, not the development of the Islamic law. The nation states are still behind the states of today, you know, here in this part. In the Arab world, they're still living in the very strict modernist nation state. And I think this is one of the bid'ahs that they need to give up. But of course, people who still control the means of violence for their own personal interests are opposing that. Hopefully, this will change. Hopefully, still the revolution, really, if I prefer to call it a revolution, different from my brother Tariq's preference. It's not a revolution. But you see, even today, I think it's a revolution that's not born yet. But it's a revolution in the pregnancy state. In the pregnancy state. But one day it will be born, and it's coming. It has to come. And it will come like when the regimes change in some countries that own Islam and claim to be. Not Tunisia and stuff. Like we need some changes in some other countries in order for the revolution to be born. People have high hopes. People are very good, and I really salute the Arab people of the past 2 years. They are very different Arab people. They really want to make a positive change. They want to stand up. And poor things, they of course, they're crushed now with people who have, you know, the arms and stuff. But they would like to stand on their feet. They would like to bring a positive change. So when they bring the revolutions, the real revolutions, and it's born, I don't think the emphasis would be that much on the law. The emphasis would be on the civilization, on the ummah. Because the ummah is the default here in the Islamic law. The Islamic law, the Quran is not speaking to the state. The Quran is speaking to the ummah. Ya ayyuhal ladheena amanu, all you believe, you know. So the ummah is the basis of the Islamic state, if you wish, or whatever. But it's not the government. I think we're going from too much emphasis on the security solution to too much emphasis on the legal solution. I think it's a phase, and hopefully we'll move from too much emphasis on one dimension to emphasis on the development with all of its dimensions, hopefully.
Okay, other questions?
Yeah, if I may ask another question. Do you think that the the inability of FIC not to provide for the control of political power, not to develop constitution and administrative law, is its success or its failure? For the time being, you have mentioned that you think that one of the areas which needs to be we should work on is FIC and politics.
Mm-hmm.
But historically, was it FIC's failure or success that it just kept itself aloof from political power?
Well, it's a long story, but historically, FIC was marginalized from the executive power, if you wish. Like, if you'd like to look at the past with contemporary eyes, the Khalifa was the executive power. He was not the legislative power. The legislative power was the ulama at that time, and the courts and so forth. Yes, the Khalifa appoints perhaps the qadi to law or something, but he does not control that. So fiqh did not really, like I would say, it failed, but it failed partially, not in every aspect of politics. It failed in bringing the ummah to the forefront, because those guys who ruled the Islamic State after the khulafa were too violent, there was too much blood. And the fuqaha's point of view at that time that there is fitna, there is so much killing if anybody is going to oppose the Khalifa. So fine, let the Khalifa do the istibdad. They kind of apologized for the istibdad, for the authoritarianism of the Khulafa. So they failed in that. But I think they did not fail to lead the Ummah in general. And they did not fail in terms of the legislative side of things. They continued to have proper courts, continued to inspire people and resolve their disputes and so forth. The fuqaha did not fail in every side. But the apologetic fiqh for authoritarianism, this has to change because we do have a lot of history of that.
I'm sorry.
Yes. We still have 10 minutes. Yes. 10 minutes. Go ahead.
But I think my question is very much related to the question that was put to you. Sometimes we feel that really the Ummah, Muslim Judaism, they failed to evolve the Muslim Islamic constitutional law. They failed to develop constitutional law on the basis of the Amruhum Shura Bainahum. And when we see the Ghazali is talking, first Al-Mawardi is talking about Imaratul Istila, providing a legal basis to justify the authoritarianism. Then we see the Ghazali is talking about Nasihatul Muluk. He's not talking about how we can implement the Amruhum Shura Bainahum. So still now, till the French Revolution, and then we see the talk Jamaluddin Afghani is talking about Istabdad, then Abduhu talking about something else, then Rashid Raza is talking about who can we reconstruct the institution of Shura in the modern age. But previously, we sometimes feel that really the Muslim jurists, they have failed to evolve Islamic constitutional law in a satisfactory manner. What do you think about
it? Well, I think the Islamic civilization was great. I mean, we should not be too harsh on the Islamic civilization, I think. When did constitutionalism evolve anywhere else, anyway? This was not something, like what I'm saying, we as human beings evolved. We went to the moon in the 60s. Yes, the Islamic civilization did not reach the moon, but it developed science in a reasonable way. So yes, they did not evolve their political theory, if you wish, to constitutionalism and everything. But let's not be too harsh on them. They did not know any of this. It was not a state in the constitutional sense anyway. It was a territory, like just an abode, you know. So it's not, I wouldn't prefer to be too harsh on the Fuqaha. Now that we have, you know, hopes for the revolution and we're trying to really have justice in the Islamic world finally and so on. And some of them were really, you know, pioneers in trying to promote the cause of justice in the societies, as Ibn Abd al-Salam and Ibn Taymiyyah and all that. So,
yes.
I've got a question about like the intellectual role that will play in this revolution and stuff, because a writer, or the Arab writer Adonis, he tried to write a magazine, a publisher, and he tried to relate it to women and women in Islam specifically. And as soon as he'd written it, he had to get the lawyers to check it. And straight away the lawyer said, no, you can't publish this, it's against the law, it's against this, you cannot do it. No one would be able to handle this case. And it just showed, like, for me, it's just looking at where is the progression. I'm hoping that there will be a progression, but I don't see, at the moment, anyone looking at this area. Is that?
Well, it depends on how we define progression, I think. I mean, especially talking about Adonis. I mean, I don't know. I mean, his stand now from the Syrian revolution is a very shameful one, to be honest. He has some ideas. I haven't read what you were talking about, but I've heard him speak a couple of times. So yes, there are some ideas that are good. There are some complaints that are valid. I think also you have, if you would like to reform a culture, you have to come from within that culture, mm-hmm. not from without.
But if it's already being censored, how will they know what they're not being shown?
But censorship. So you're saying that. What do you mean by censorship?
It's just the fact that if all the women that are going about their daily lives and stuff, they don't get to read about the things that intellectuals like poets and other writers are able to do or are able to think about, because automatically they're stopped because no one is able to allow that sort of think progression of thinking.
Well, no, I don't think this is an accurate picture of the Middle East. Most women don't read because they're illiterate, because they don't, you know, the Adonis is censored. Well, no, I mean, the problems are much more basic than that, especially women's problems, you know. And yes, he does talk about some women's rights and everything, but you need to move them at least to literacy and give them some basic rights and prevent violence from happening to them. In a way that some people justify, etc. And then you can talk about, you know, the great poetry of Adonis. You see.
Well, I mean, it's just anyone writing about it. You know? So I just picked him because I saw that he tried to publish something and it just got stopped. That was my main thing. Like, it's the censorship, it's the control that they have over what people would write.
There is a concern. I'm concerned too, post-revolution, about women's rights, to be honest, because the trend. Post-evolution is quite an extreme trend, and I think it's a phase, but it is happening. And the extreme trend is going against women's rights, even in some legal reforms that Mubarak or others have done. They were a mixture of things, but some of them were serious reforms that happened. Some people are trying to backtrack that in the name that it was Mubarak who suggested that law. Women's, for example, women's divorce rights in Egypt. Some people in the parliament now are fighting against that, trying to cancel women's divorce rights, which came to Egyptian women after forever, you know, only in the 90s. So that is a problem. I share your concern, but I think that the problems are very basic, are really basic. This part of the world would not have gone in the streets and subjected themselves to danger unless the situation had gone really, really bad. And the situation is bad so far. Nothing changed so far, really.
Just to follow on this question, from an ethical viewpoint, do you think that it should be right to put as something which is central in all this discussion with the uprisings or the revolutions, freedom of expression, something which is central? Because I was in Tunisia, they said exactly the same. They said the problem that we have with the people, whoever they are, is that freedom of expression is not something that we have. From an ethical viewpoint, we want a free democratic society, but we are not clear on freedom of expression. The same in Egypt, the same in Libya these days. So what do you think about that? Is this something, this is in fact part of your point?
Yeah, I think we lack freedom of expression still in these countries because the revolutions or half revolutions, whatever had happened, was hijacked. People who really stood in the streets and subjected themselves to danger for the sake of these like pregnancy revolutions to happen, they believed in freedom of expression. Islamists and Christians and seculars and everybody alike. The people who were, for example, in Tahrir Square or in Tunisia in front of the Minister of Interior, they believed in freedom, whoever they are. And their ceiling of freedom of expression is very high. Yet, people who ended up in the parliaments are not the same species. It's different. And therefore, now we're having people who used the uprisings for their own political interests and trying to put their own bit and their own ideologies that are different from what the people wanted. So I think if the revolutions are born at last, you will see a better freedom of expression and other freedoms. And you will see them quite balanced. They will not be un-Islamic or anything, because the Ummah is aware, the people are aware. And it depends on whether you trust the people and their consciousness, or you think that the public is foolish and you don't trust their collective opinions.
Okay. I think it's, thank you so much. Thank you so much for coming all the way from Qatar to give this introductory lecture. Next week, we'll have Dr. Ayman Shehadeh from the SOAS, who is going to talk about theories of ethical value in medieval Islamic thought, a new interpretation. This will be next week at the same time. I want to thank once again the Oxford Center of Islamic Studies, and as you know, this is a collaboration with the Middle East Center and the Center for Islamic Legislation and Ethics. So hopefully you will follow the whole series and be with us. And I don't know if you want to add something at the end. Thank you so much. Thanks a lot. If you want to see, have a look at the books, they are here.